well, we're going to be in the book of Exodus, 15th chapter. We'll use some reference scriptures today. We'll see why we sing songs to the Lord. There's a reason. What does God expect of us? What does he really require of us? We have been studying about Joseph, his character, seeing that, how the Lord delivered him out of his circumstances, how the Lord worked through, turned those circumstances to Joseph's benefit, and to deliver him from the people's sin. We finished up Genesis last week. I believe it said something at the end of Genesis that there was a new king, a new pharaoh. What verse was that? We remember reasons. But we found out that Joseph died in Egypt, and we understand that a new pharaoh arose to deal with the affairs of Egypt. That's in Exodus 1st chapter, verse 8. Now there arose a new king over Egypt, which knew not Joseph. So all that favor that Joseph had with the old king has faded away. The Egyptian people, Israelites have multiplied, and the Egyptians have made slaves out of them, which was prophesied. This is what's going to happen when they go into this land, traveling to the promised land, getting to the promised land. Now, redemption that happened to Israel, the life saving of them. First was they were preserved as a nation through Joseph. And then they were rescued as a nation through Moses. So now, if we parallel that to ourselves, when we were coming up as kids, our parents prepared us, sent us to Sunday school, church school, all BYU, what's the other stuff? That's kind of getting you conditioned for the realities of the Bible. We draw pictures of and the coloring books and all like that. Make your little Bible verse. You've been prepared. So you've been preserved. Then one day you have to come to the reality that I didn't saved. You would proclaim yourself, your belief in Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and salvation would be a reality in your life. That's called exiting out of the influences, dictates of sin. And now that you get out of that, now you have to know how to walk in victory in your redemption. Some people are still stuck in just being rescued. Being rescued. That's what we're going to read today, is that they got rescued. Now that you get rescued, what do you do after you get rescued? See if we can get that all tied in together. The theme of today's lesson is God expects and requires us to obey him. Okay. Some of the instruments of war, instruments that the devil used to keep you trapped, you can think about that, what that was, but four is the Israelites was concerned. The Egyptians, they used chariots and they used horses. That was their instrument of war. Superior instruments when it came to war. Chariots and horses. This reality that we're going to see today, let's see if we can go there. Look at Exodus 14 and 4. Okay. 14:4. And we'll read in the Bible. We want to read it the way it says, but we want to see. I'm about to challenge the class. Someone wants to read that verse 4.
I'll be your huckleberry.
Okay.
And I will harden Pharaoh's heart, that he shall follow after them, and it will be honored upon Pharaoh and upon all his host, that the Egyptians may know that I am the Lord. And they did so.
Okay, the first sentence of that verse, and I will harden Pharaoh's heart. That means that the Lord would make Pharaoh not want to love God. God deliberately manipulated Pharaoh's heart to that there was no way that for him to get salvation, that he would always hate God and hate God's people. So I throw that out to the class today. Is that what God did to Pharaoh? Made his heart where he wouldn't love God, would not love his people. That should be that. Read it again. That's what it says. And I will harden Pharaoh's heart. I will harden Pharaoh's heart. I will harden Pharaoh's heart. I will harden your neighbor's heart. I will fix your neighbor so that he would not love me, would not ever want any of my agenda. He's always going to be against me. I'm going to fix him like that, and then I'm going to use what I did against him to save some more people. Is that how you read it? So, when we read the Bible, we have to read it in the light of reality, of God's character, his mercy, his love, and all of that. That's why you should always read the Bible in the light of your revelation. Because God, if that was true, God could have said, I'm going to fix him, where he's going to always hate me. And when he comes in, his future, I'm going to allow him to mess up. But the other people I'm going to save, I'm going to always mess his heart up to where he won't love me. So we read this, and so it says, I will harden Pharaoh's heart. But God is saying, being all-knowing and all-wise, is that I know how Pharaoh feels. How many of those people, you know how they are, how they're going to react to the situation? I already know how he is. I already know what he's going to say. I already know what he's going to do. I always going to know what side he's going to come down on. I already know that about this particular individual. So God is saying that I know what Pharaoh is going to do. I know what he's going to say. I know that if he doesn't love me, doesn't mean that I'm fixed him up the way he doesn't love me. I know that he does not love my cause. That's what that is. I know how he already is. So, don't get into a Bible teaching. Let a preacher preach to you. God says, I made Pharaoh to hate me. I intentionally created him to hate me. That's not what it says. So, and then in that sentence, it says, and I will be honored among Pharaoh and upon all his hosts. I will be honored. That the Egyptians may know that what? I am the Lord. And they did so. Where Moses got to know God at the burning bush, and Moses would ask God, you're sending me up to Pharaoh to say, let your people go. Pharaoh, you know how he is, God. You already know how he is. So what am I going to say to Pharaoh as to who told me to come up here and tell you to let God's people go? What am I going to say to you? And God told Moses, tell Pharaoh what I am. Sent you. Who? I am. Who's I am? I am is who? Yahweh. The Almighty God. The only God. Invisible God. The everlasting one. Tell Pharaoh that's who I am, and tell Pharaoh I sent you to tell him to let my people go. And so Pharaoh, we know the story, Pharaoh didn't want to do that. God already knew how Pharaoh's heart was. He already knew how Pharaoh was. Pharaoh could, if he wanted to, obey the instructions, but God knew that he wouldn't. So that's how God says, He says, I will harden his heart. God says, I know what he's like. I know what he's doing. I already know. Some people today, in this modern age, that God knows what they're going to do because it's salvation. Woo! Some people, when we give them the simplicity of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, God knows how they're going to react. Surely is going to say, yeah. If she get the news, the good news, in a proper way, if you present it to her, some old joke on the street corner out here, he ain't going. But some people, when they hear it, will say yeah to it. And that's the problem, is that Romans 10, 9, 10, something, I think it's about verse 11. How can they hear it unless you present it? How can you present it to them unless you are sent to give it to them? And he says, they'll never have the faith for it until they hear it. So Pharaoh got the opportunity to get the faith and believe it, but he, God says, I know he won't. So God says, I already know that character. Mm-hmm. I already know that character. But he's in a powerful position. He's got my people in bondage. And you tell him, I said, let him go. So, all right, now let's see where we were. Y'all got me all off track. Okay. The instruments of war are the chariots and the horses. And we're going to see a celebration song. I don't think they took drums and horns and guitars and everything else when they composed this song. Oh, we're about to be in trouble. I might as well stay in trouble. Ready for this? I think there's too much instruments in songs. I don't think we put the instruments in the proper place. I think the instruments sometimes get the music instruments. That's what I mean. I think the song of deliverance is from the what? So I need those skillful sound to get my heart to tell me to say something about that. I trust y'all quarterback. So once they realize that they were delivered, I'm saved. I know who I am in Christ. I know who I am. Once that became a reality, that's what happened in Exodus 15 and 1. It was spontaneous. And I think when they was running for their lives, they didn't pack up the drums. They just got out of there, running for their lives. Up against this wall, up against this water. Whoops, look who's behind us, the Egyptians. Water before us. Moses, you got to do something. And then after it was all said, we'll finally lead to after the deliverance. This is what they said. This is what happened. What happened? Exodus 15.
Didn't
say
Moses and the children of Israel came out of this song into the Lord. Mm-hmm. And spake, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and his rider hath he thrown into the sea.
Then sang Moses. Then sang Moses. Moses started singing. And the children of Israel started singing. And spake. And the Lord, and this song unto the Lord. They sung unto the Lord. And they talked unto the Lord. And they said, in a song, he had triumphed what? Gloriously. I don't know if Moses was a, what's the levels of voices we got here? What do you call them? Alto? Soprano? I don't know what it is. He was singing. And he was singing that. And the Lord has thrown him in the sea. The horse and his rider. All of those instruments that the devil had against me, the Lord has triumphed over them all. Going to keep me in bondage. Now, I call them songs of deliverance. Once you realize that you are saved and you're not in the trap of the devil anymore, you should have a song of deliverance. You should have a song, something you can say. You can sing and say it. Now, this is recorded throughout the Bible many times. I look at some more songs of deliverance from oppression, oppressors. Look at Psalms 13 and 6. One of my favorite ones is in Psalms 27 and 6. Psalms 27 is recently. Let's go there right quick. Psalms 27. I like Psalms 27. I poured it quite a bit. Okay. Psalms 27. That was the Psalm 27 and 6. Out of that Psalm. But the Psalms is full of songs of deliverance. This is what he says. You know, sometimes I say, the Lord is my life, the Lord is my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the strength of my life. What shall I be afraid of? And jump down to verse 6. Now shall my head be lifted up above who? Round about me. Round about me. Therefore, while offering his sacrifices of joy, I will sing what? Songs. I will sing praises unto the Lord. Now, what you see there in verse 6 is reality that I got saved, I got delivered, but guess who was still around? My enemies. Wish I could tell you get saved and your enemies have disappeared. No. Get saved, they still around. Yeah. But anyway, no. They don't go underground. They move next door.
People
But I'm delivered. But they're still around me. But I look up above them all and I sing songs of deliverance. I'm delivered. I'm saved. Filled with the Holy Ghost. All kinds of stuff. Pass through the red light district. Pass through the blue light district. Pass through the billboards all over town. It's nothing but instruments of sin. But what? I'm delivered. Get saved, but your enemies are still around somewhere. I'm going to try to bring you back into the influence of their oppression. All right, let's find another song. If we do it right quick, Psalms 13 and 6. Okay. Notice all of this is going on in these songs. The instrument is the instrument of the what? The voice. The voice. The voice. Okay, what do you say? 13 and 6. Someone's reading.
I will sing unto the Lord because he hath dealt bountifully.
I will sing unto the Lord because he hath dealt bountifully. I will turn on the radio. Let's turn on the CD player. Turn on the album. No, I will. I will. Me, he's going to. I will sing. You probably gather some strength. I have to do mine in my showers. Some people have to pee. And I don't want to hear it, so I just do it in the shower. In the car by myself. There you go, singing unto the Lord. It's not like a moose call. That's a thing in the Lord. We got our own. But as long as it's you doing it with your voice, whatever quality of voice you got, you're talking about your glory. You're acknowledging, glorifying God. Okay. I see we find another one. 33 and 2. Psalms 33 and 2. We're going to get into instrumentation. Someone read that, please.
Praise ye the Lord because sing unto him with the psaltery and an instrument of ten strings.
Okay, verse 3.
Sing unto him a new song. Play skips with a loud noise.
Okay, all right. So here we're going to mix them up. We got music and we got voices. Okay, we're mixing them up. And that was 33. What about Psalms 34? What was out here? It doesn't say much about the voice in the fourth verse, but this is a song here. Verse 3 says, for thou art my rock and my fortress, therefore for thy name's sake, lead me and guide me. Pull me out of the net that they had laid for me, for thou art my strength. Parallel that to what the Israelites was going on. Here's the trap, the Red Sea. We've got to run in, and what do we run into? Getting away from the Egyptians or a sea. How are we going to get across this? They're pursuing us.
Yeah, what verse did you say?
What did I do? Mess up? 30 and 4. Sing unto the Lord. All ye saints of his, and give thanks unto remembrance of us. Still no instruments there, but sing unto the Lord. Who? Saints. Sing. Saints, sing unto them. You go into the churches that don't sing, and they have confrontations, whether it's contemporary, traditional, or whatever kind of worship service they got going in the days. Stupidity. Save me. Reverend, just raise your voice and sing a song. Some people get caught up in that, not to be a part. So sing unto the Lord. Now, so here we got to understand that they got delivered, and they immediately turn around and sing a song of praise. Verse 2 says, okay, I'm sorry.
One thing I want to point out there, now they were singing, you know, you were talking about these other situations back to David. Mm-hmm. This is, you know, in the song that was written after these children had learned this story. Mm-hmm. They can sing in the midst of their troubles, mm-hmm. Songs looking over the head of the enemy. Mm-hmm. But these guys were singing because the enemies, all of them, had disappeared. Yeah. But it was David and the psalmist, they had learned about all these things God done. They know the history of God, so they could sing in the midst of
that. David is singing about the history, and he has some personal mm-hmm. stuff in here. But he can relate back. Oh, yeah. My daddy told me about what happened to my great-great-dad back then. And they were delivered. So and if they wouldn't deliver it back then, man, we would be in bondage right now.
Psalms 106.
Okay,
our fathers understood, this starts at verse 7. Our fathers understood not thy wonders in Egypt. They remembered not the multitude of thy mercy, but provoked them at the sea, even at the Red Sea. Nevertheless, he saved them for his name's sake, that he might make his mighty power be known.
Right.
Okay. And then at verse 10, he saved them from the hand of him that hated them and redeemed them from the hand of the enemy. The waters covered their enemies, and there was not one of them left. Then they believed, and they this his words, and they sang his praise.
And they sang his praise. Okay, now, so gratitude is expressed through the song. Gratitude. Once you get delivered, and you know you've been delivered, you express it in the song. You had nothing to sing about unless there was some deliverance. Can't even compose a song until you realize the deliverance. You can't even compose the song until you realize the deliverance. What you gonna sing about?
The blues.
That's right.
That's what the blues is.
That's what the blues is. That oppression. Sing that until we get delivered. You probably won't get delivered. All right. So gratitude is what they expressed immediately. All right. Now, let's see here. They sung the song based on the reality of their deliverance and salvation, and that was based on a physical manifestation. I'm out of Egypt over here. See? Now, when we get saved and come to the Lord, it's not based on physical observations. It's based on the heart, what you feel, what you believe. That's called faith. We walk by faith. They walk by what they saw. They composed the song by what they saw. We have to compose the song about what we have here. Faith. Now, these guys were not walking in faith. They were walking in nothing but obedience. Obedience, God says, if you turn right and go straight up that hill and hit that sea, you'll make it. That's what they had to do. Obedience. Us, we have to even not only hear the instructions, but we got to believe in the instructions. We have to walk according to the instructions, which is the word. When the enemies are still around about us, moved in next door. Okay, my partner at work, whatever. The enemies. That's how close the enemies would get, but you still, we have to walk in and believe faith. Talk faith. Compose a song of faith. Testimony of faith. Overcome him by the blood of the Lamb and what the word of what I'm saying. I'm overcoming. I'm winning. Okay, so let's see what the difference between us and them. We know that now. All right. According to our lesson, verse 2, the Lord is my what?
Strength
and song. and he has become my salvation. Woo! He is, but he was talking, wasn't he? He is my God. And you got to understand, they ain't seen God. Nothing like that. But all they know is that this, you see what he just did? Now, what did he just do? We'll talk about that in a minute. I will prepare him a what? Habitation, my Father's God, and I will exalt him. So they knew that they've been saved. Now, verse 3, the Lord is a man of war, true or false. Well, if y'all was around here this summer, you realize he's a God of war. He's going to come on a horse one day. He's going to be such a bad character, he'll have his name tattooed on his thigh. Lord of Lords. What are you going to say? Lord of Lords. That's annoying. So he's a man of war. When it comes time for fighting, he comes in and he'll pull a, what's the name of that outfit now that's going in rescuing everybody?
The SEAL team.
What is it? Yeah, SEAL team something. I don't know. SEAL team 6. He's better than them. So he come in, he's coming in, God gave a pretty graphic explanation of graphic what kind of guys was born. I can't say it in church. But it's something like they come in and kick rear. Start with an A. Ended with an S.
They don't negotiate.
Those guys are trained to kill and win. That's all they come in. They ain't got time to talk about nothing. Come in. So the Lord one day is going to appear like that as a man of war. So the Lord is a man of war. And, well, who is this man of war? It says what? Yahweh is his name. The Lord is his name. And this is where you find out his name, Exodus 3 and 13. Find the Lord's name. What's your name? Moses, what should I tell him? Who are you? 13 and 3. Where was I? That's not where you're going to find Yahweh, but that's 13 and 3 said, Moses said unto the people, remember this day in which you came out of Egypt, which the day that you came out of bondage, out of the house of bondage, for by the strength of the hand of the Lord brought you out from this place, there shall no leavened bread be eaten. Now Israel marks this is a mark in the life of every Hebrew. Every Hebrew, every Jew that's alive today can point you to this day they were saved. He came out of Egypt. He got delivered from Egypt. Back on that day, we ain't going back into bondage. Today, modern day, Israel has a peace treaty with Egypt. They get along pretty good. But Israel is saying right now that they ain't ever going to be another day. We'll be slaves. That's why the world is kind of on the edge right now, because they think that Israel would start a fight. Just if you just look at it. That's why everybody's checking out Iran and Israel right now. Watch, because Israel ain't waiting until the last minute. They'll jump first, come down to it. They ain't never going back to what they were doing. That's the people. Okay, now. All right, Songs of Deliverance, Exodus. All right, now. Let's look at our lesson again. Yahweh is his name. That's my name. For the horse, verse 19, I'm going to jump. Exodus 15, verse 19. For the horse of Pharaoh went in with his chariots and with his horsemen into the sea. And the Lord brought again the waters of the sea upon them. But the children of Israel went on dry land in the midst of the sea. So we know the story. The children of Israel went across the sea on dry land. And the formation was that the waters rose up and it was like a wall of water. A wall of water over there. And the children of Israel just walked through. Not only the ground wasn't even soggy, it was dry. So they just walked through to the other side. And So they got over there, the children, and now that's called a baptism. Let's call it baptism. It's called a baptism. Now it kind of lets us know the reality of what we should be doing today. The children of Israel had to submit to Moses, go in, step in the water. And when you step in the water will become like a wall, the ground will become a dry land, and you walk through. Now, some folks, I know in my neighborhood, say, Moses, you crazy, you see all that water out there. Put your foot in. Walk, dry land. Now walk. That's called obedience. You have to submit. Obedience. Now, there's a baptism that we have to submit to according to the spiritual leaders and according to the Word of God. There's some things that you have to submit to. One of them is baptism. Baptism. Don't resist it. Jesus put a lot of emphasis on baptism. Matthew 28. 19. I know Mark 16 and 16. Let's see what Matthew 28 says. Something about the water baptism. 28 and 19. Go ye therefore, teach all nations. Doing what?
Baptizing.
Baptizing them. In the name of the Father, the Son, of the Holy Ghost. Teach them to observe. Baptize them. Then you got Mark 16:16. He that believes and is what? Baptized. Not he that is baptized, but he that is believing and is baptized shall be saved. He who believes and is baptized should be saved. I mean, we got a lot of people being baptized but not believing. A lot of baptism, nobody in faith. He that's in faith and is baptized will be saved. So act of obedience, submission. Submission means you're going to submit to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Okay, now back to our lesson again. For the horses, verse 19, for the horse of Pharaoh went in with his chariots, his horsemen into the sea, and the Lord brought again the waters of the sea upon them. The children of Israel went on dry land in the midst of the sea. Jump to verse 22. So Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea. Moses brought Israel from the Red Sea. They went out into the wilderness of Shur, and they went there, they went 3 days in the wilderness and found no water. Now, 3 days without water is a pretty serious situation. What's the longest anybody has ever went in here without taking a drink? Don't even think about it. I'm drinking. Something in me tell me to get a drink, and I'm going to get a drink of water. You can't come drinking. So you can live without anything on earth, but you got to have what? Water. Athletes know this. For some strange thing, once I've exhausted myself, exerted a lot of energy and everything, all I need is a little strength. Aren't you a ball player? Maybe a little strength, so I almost playing. Run sprints. I'm tired, 100 degrees, so I can throw your ball in water, ready to go. Something in water. Now, I go 3 days without any water. That's some serious stuff. So, the children of Israel are not going to approach Moses politely. Moses, you got any ice? They're going to say, Moses, what kind of a leader are you? You leading us where there is no water. Haven't you thought about the water? Where is the water? And I'm pretty sure they have some other choice words. Where's the water? Not only for me, look at my kids. Got everybody out here, we're following you. You ain't even leading us to what navigation chart are you looking at? So, all right. And when they came to Marah, they could not drink. They finally went to a place Well, there is some water. There it is right there. Phew, man, okay, fine. And when they got there, what they find out? You can't drink this water. If you drank it, you showed up then. Anybody have a Pookie, tell me about the sea that's got all the salt in it?
Dead Sea.
You can tell me something about the Dead Sea.
Water dead, it's salted.
There's no life in the water. How about the quality of that water? Is enough to, I mean, produce, just put it on your tongue, you did. So, okay, Moses, you hung this, and you brought us to some water. We can't even drink the stuff. Where is your navigation system? What are you doing? How many would be ready to, gratitude, hero? Now you weigh nothing.
3 days.
Now you ain't nothing. Matter of fact, life is on the line. Anybody ever got into a trial, a test, something like that? Well, it ain't looking good. We're about to go up. We're going under. No. So here's the thing. You get delivered, but it doesn't take away the challenges. Salvation does not take away the challenges of life. Ooh. The answer to that dilemma is, what are you going to do with your situation? What are you going to do? What would you do? No water? 3 days? I need some water. I know I got saved and got baptized. Ooh, what am I going to do for some money? I used to be able to make some money doing. I used to get me some quick money.
Working at McDonald's.
it takes a week to get paid there, right? I'm talking about by sundown. I need some money, honey. How many knew some quick ways to get a buck? I won't look at you. I won't see who it was. But I know a way how to get some money. So, this is where now we come down to obedience. Are you going to stay in obedience to God's word, which means demonstration of faith, or are you going to add the food? That's where they are, and they're pressing Moses. Moses, oh boy. And they came to him. And when they came to Marah, they could not drink of the waters of Marah, for they were bitter. And that's why they named the place that. And the people murmured against Moses, saying, okay, what are we going to drink? The head of the house, the kids, you the head, what are we going to eat? We're going to get gas money. See, these kind of challenges don't go away just because you got what? Saved. Well, someone tell me what Moses did. He cried unto the Lord. He went to the piano. He went to the drums. Trumpet. He had one instrument. One amplification. His voice. Lord, I don't know, I can't imagine, but I know I've cried to the Lord. And I know what, Lord, help me, hallelujah. Lord, look at this, you got to get in there and you got to lay in your cards on the table. Can't be saying, well, Lord, you got to talk to him like he was your best friend. Where are we going to find somebody? What are we going to do to get me some money, whatever that need might be? Some health, some wisdom, some happiness. What are we going to do? Because on the ground where the rubber meets the road, it ain't so good down here. What what are we going to do? The Lord ain't going to tell you you're going to turn on the radio. FM 9, whatever it might be. Christian radio station. Go read pamphlets. Or that. Not more than likely he's not going to tell you. He's going to give you an answer. But he needs to see you holler. That's what the kids say today, holler. He needs to see you holler. Tell him something. Okay. All right. He cried unto the Lord, and God showed, right? Mm-hmm. He cried, and then God showed. That's what we got to be keen with. When I cry, when I go in prayer, when I come out of prayer, I need to be looking. I need to be looking for my answer. Okay. I need to be looking to see the children of Israel way back before this.